Welcome to my tutorial on Ohm's Law. I'm going to be showing you how to use Ohm's Law to solve some really basic electrical and electronics problems. This is actually a really useful tool here to know how to do. Also on the left-hand side, I've got my Ohm's Law calculator. If you're watching this video on YouTube, then you can pick that up from the App Store, and I'll post a link down in the description on where you can find that if you're interested in it. Otherwise, I'll be showing you how to do this by hand or just with a regular calculator if you need to. And trying to give you a basic understanding on Ohm's Law and, you know, how it works and why it works. So a useful tool I like to use to describe Ohm's Law and to describe how voltage and current and resistance are all related to each other is a picture of two tanks of water. Because voltage is really just a difference in potential between two areas. So tank A, we'll say that this has 8 volts. And tank B just has 4 volts. So there is a difference in potential of 4 volts. And we imagine that's water. If there's more water in tank A than in tank B and that level is higher, that water is going to want to try and get over to tank B. So that difference, like I said, is that's measured in volts. Also, voltage, current, resistance, and power, they all use the metric system in their measurements, so you can do conversions between. If you have a lot of volts, you can convert that up to kilovolts. So if you had 1,000 volts, that would be 1 kilovolt, or if you had 30,000 volts, it would be 30 kilovolts. Also, if you want to get smaller and measure a smaller amount, you would use millivolts, and that's 1/1000th of a volt. So if I had 0.002 volts, you could measure that in millivolts, and it just saves you a little bit of space in writing it. In my application, if you do a conversion and it comes out with an answer that's in a really small or a really big value, it'll go ahead and convert that over to millivolts or mega ohms or whatever the case is, whatever appropriate for that. But otherwise, that's how you do that by hand. So I have an interactive problem here, so you can get a little practice with that. If you have 3.6 kilovolts, how many volts is that going to be? Well, basically, you just times that 3.6 by 1,000, or you can, you know, move that decimal over three places, and that's going to give you 3,600 volts. So the second thing that we need to know is we have our difference in potential there, our water level over there, and our water level over here. Like I said, that water is going to want to go from tank A into tank B, and so the rate at which that water is flowing from tank A to tank B is what we call current. And in current, we're going to measure that in ampere or an amp. And 1 ampere is usually quite a bit. You're not going to use, in electronics, you're not going to use 1 amp quite so much. You're going to use milliamp in most cases. Although if you're doing some electrical work like, you know, wiring up a house or something, then amps would probably be the more appropriate measurement to give that in. So I have an interactive problem here again. We have 350 milliamps. How many amps is that? So just like with volts, we're going to do, because we're making this into the higher value now of amps, we're going to have to move that decimal over three places to the left, and that's going to give us 0.35 amps is 350 milliamps. And like I said, my calculator program, that's going to do that conversion for you automatically, so you don't have to do that. But just in case you get confused and you're converting something and you need to try and give an answer in volts versus kilovolts, then you can do that on your own. But it's relatively simple to do. All right. So the thing, if we have voltage, we have a certain level of voltage, and we have a certain level of amperage, those two things are related. And the thing that determines what your amperage is going to be for a given voltage is going to be your resistance. Your resistance is what we measure in ohms, and that's essentially what that size that pipe is. Whether that size, if that pipe is a very small pipe, we would say that's a high resistance. So a large value in ohms would mean a very small pipe. There's a lot of resistance there, but a low value in ohms would be a very large pipe that allows the current to travel, you know, much more. Like I said, resistance is measured in ohms. It's determined primarily by the physical structure of the material. I have a picture of two atoms down here. You can see that atom, or the two atoms in A are much closer together than the two atoms in B. So basically all electricity is it's extra electrons that are moving from an atom that has more electrons to an atom that has less electrons. So if, you know, the atom on the left-hand side of A is very close to the atom on the left-hand side or the right-hand side of A, then it's going to be very easy for those electrons to travel in between the two atoms. But there's also some other things that affect resistance, and those are things like the length of the material, because basically you just have more material that it's going to cross through or travel through, the cross-sectional area of the material, how thick the material is, and the temperature of the material also affects it too. There's something that's known as a positive or a negative temperature coefficient. Most things have a positive coefficient, but some things like carbon have a negative coefficient. So what that means basically is that if you have some kind of wire or something that those electrons are traveling through, they've got to get from one side to the other side. And now, when something's hot, that means that all the atoms inside this are vibrating really fast when something's hot. That's basically all heat is that vibration. And that vibration is going to slow down those electrons. It's going to make it harder for them to get across. But then if something has a negative coefficient, then it actually works the opposite way, and the electrons can be able to get across easier, even though it's a hotter temperature. But like I said, that's kind of unusual. Most materials have a positive coefficient, so it's going to be more difficult for those atoms or the electrons to travel across the atoms when it's hotter. And that's why, like, a lot of the supercomputers end up, you know, they try and run them at a super cold temperature, because it actually helps those electrons move. Conductance, you can measure that in Mohs. We're not going to get into that too much. That's more of on the engineering side, which later on you can cover that if you get more into electronics and electricity. So then that brings us to Ohm's law. So like you saw with those two buckets of water, the voltage and the current and the resistance are all related. So that means that if you have two of those values, you can figure out what the other value is. And this is commonly written out as E equals I times R. I wrote it as V in here in this slide, but you can write it either way. I see E a little bit more often, but it probably just depends on what you're reading. So E equals I times R. So that's your voltage is equal to your current times your resistance. Same thing, V equals I times R. Voltage is equal to current times resistance. Same thing. So with that, we're going to do some little example problems here. So we'll go ahead, and every time that we're going to do some kind of problem with Ohm's law, it's good for you to just go ahead and write out at the top, E equals I times R, and that's going to help you remember what you're trying to do there. E equals I times R. So let's say, for instance, that I have 2 volts, and I have a current of 0.5 amps. Now I have my voltage and I have my current, but I don't have my resistance. So I need to try and figure out what my resistance is. So what we're gonna do to figure that out is just some basic algebra there. So what we're gonna do is we need to get resistance by itself. So I'm gonna divide both sides by the current. And this is just some basic algebra here. And then in the end, that's going to give us, we're going to cancel out the two I's over here. So that gives us E, so our voltage divided by our current is equal to our resistance. All right. So with that, we can take this and we can put our 2 into our voltage, our 0.5 amps, into our resistance, or into our current, and then that will give us our resistance, which will be 4 ohms. So now we can check that over here using the calculator. So I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to enter in 2 volts, and I'm going to select my current, enter in 0.5 amps, and that's going to give me 4 ohms. And it's also going to give me 1 watt, which I'm going to show you right now how to figure out the wattage, which that's actually using Joule's law, but it goes right hand in hand with Ohm's law. All right, so Joule's law is your power equals your voltage times your current. Remember that Ohm's law is equal to voltage equals current times resistance. So using those two things, we can figure out a bunch of different equations for this to figure out our unknowns. And so saying that your voltage times your current, because your voltage is also your current times your resistance, you could also rewrite that out as your power equals your current times resistance times current. So that would be your current squared times resistance. So you write that out like that. Or you could also write that out as P equals, we could say our voltage, and then since your current is equal to voltage over resistance, you could say that that's E times voltage over resistance, which is the same thing as saying P equals E squared over R. All right, so with that, with our previous example, we had said that we had 2 volts, we had 0.5 amps, and then using that, we figured out that we had 4 ohms. So let's use this to figure out what our wattage would be. So now we have, we know we have two volts, and then we have 0.5 amps. So 2 times 0.5, that would equal 1. And we got that 1 right over there. So with that, let's say we want to try and figure out, like, let's say that we have 0.5 watts. So 0.5 watts. And we know that we have 50 ohms. But let's say that we need to figure out what our voltage and what our current is from that. So what we're going to do, because we know that we have our wattage, and then we also have our resistance. So there's our wattage and our resistance. What we can do is we can multiply both sides of those out to get rid of that on the right side. So this times resistance, and power times resistance, because that'll get rid of our R right there. So what it's going to leave us with is resistance times power equals our voltage squared. And now to get rid of that square, we can just square root both sides. So square root that side, square root that side. We write that as the resistance times power square root equals our voltage. And so our resistance is 0.5, and our power is 50. So 0.5 times 50, that would be the square root of 25. Or you could also write that out. So square root of 25 is 5. So our voltage equals 5. All right, now using that, we can find out some really useful stuff. So let's say, for instance, that you have a piece of cabling, a piece of wire that's rated to 16 amps. And let's say that we know that we have 120 volt power in our building. So using that, how many watts can we get out of that wire? What's the maximum wattage that wire is rated to? All right, so we know that our voltage is 120, and we know that our maximum amperage rating is 16 amps. So looking back at Joule's law, we have P equals E times I, or we could also write that as P divided by E equals I. So we have our power divided by our voltage equals our current. So to get the power by itself now. We just times 120 by 16, which gives us 1,920, which could also be written as 1.92 kilowatts, because that's 1,920 watts. So we can check this real quick. We know that our voltage is 120. We know that our current is 16. And then that's going to give us 1.92 kilowatts.